Ford Motor Company, maker of Ford Falcon, Fairlane, Galaxy, Thunderbird, Mercury Comet, Meteor, Monterey, and Lincoln Continental, presents the award-winning program Leonard Bernstein and the New York Philharmonic in The Creative Performer, with special guests Glenn Gould, Eileen Farrell, and Igor Stravinsky. Produced by Robert Sodeck Associates.
Just heard the first 36 bars of Beethoven's Third Symphony, the Eroica, conducted by a maestro we shall call A. Maestro A is a dramatic soul, and for him, Beethoven's gigantic composition is a fierce, taut, and shattering experience. He is also a dedicated antagonist of his famous rival, Maestro Z, who views the symphony quite differently through what one might call a rose-colored telescope. For him, the Eroica sings. It is a noble, exalted, lyrical outpouring in the nostalgic German tradition he loves so well. Here he comes now to show you his conception of the same music. Can those two performances be so different? After all, we're dealing with a score, a published record of certain utterances by Beethoven, clearly and unmistakably conveyed by the hieroglyphic of musical notation. Shouldn't it then mean the same thing to all men? Yes, but remember that this score only half exists. It's only a score, a printed record, until performers take it, assimilate it, combine their energies with its dormant ones, and spark it to life by performing it. Who are these performers? What do they really do? How can we recognize whether they are gifted or not? Why does one performer excite or satisfy more than another? To put it bluntly, why does one artist earn 10 times the fee of another? What is this art of performing? Well, our two conductors, A and Z, are performers. Theoretically, their instrument is this hundred-headed orchestra, which is also a collection of performers, making the problem a bit more complicated. But theoretically, at least, it's up to A and Z to determine what the orchestra will do. But what do A and Z want? Well, whatever they want, it's got to stem from still another question. What does Beethoven want? All right, let's look at the score and see what he tells us he wants as regards, for example, tempo. He marks his first movement allegro con brio, meaning fast, with fiery spirit. But there are all kinds of fasts, and so Beethoven supplies us with a metronome mark, a dotted half note equals 60, which tells us that throughout this movement, a full bar of music must move at a rate of speed equal to 60 bars per minute, or exactly one per second, like this. Each one of those ticks is one bar. All right, there are 691 bars of music in this movement, and by the simplest arithmetical calculation, we can deduce that the whole movement must take 691 seconds to perform, which is 11 and a half minutes. Well, I've done a little investigating, and I can tell you that no conductor, to my knowledge, has ever done this movement in under 13 minutes. Toscanini took 13 minutes and 20 seconds, Bruno Walter 14 minutes, and Koussevitzky 14 and a half minutes. What a terrible piece of news we've uncovered. Whatever the explanation is, it seems almost too shocking to reveal publicly on television. For it must be either that Beethoven gave us false information about his musical intentions, or that Toscanini and everyone else have simply ignored Beethoven's wishes. Can this be true? Of course not. The explanation lies in the human factor, a factor that cannot possibly remain glued to any mathematical formula throughout a piece of music. At best, that metronome mark of 60 can mean only in the neighborhood of 60. After all, there's our friend conductor Z, the lyrical one, who understands the tempo of the main theme to lie just a shade under 60, so that the theme will emerge more gently, perhaps nobler, more imposing. Whereas dramatic old conductor A will want it to move a bit faster than 60, swift and agitated, like this. But that's still not the whole story. If it were only a matter of A or Z picking one tempo and sticking to it, the problem wouldn't be very subtle at all. But there's no such thing in music as tempo divorced from all other considerations. Tempi must be gauged in accordance with so many other factors and functions that it all becomes almost too much for the conscious mind. And that's why the performer's instincts are so important. It is those instincts that we treasure, that we call the artist's gift. For example, our gifted conductor A, who wants to give a generally dramatic reading of the symphony, has an idea. Look, he says, I can magnify the sense of drama right at the outset with those two opening chords by prolonging ever so slightly the pauses that follow them. Now, we all know that silence in the right places can be the most electrifying thing in all music. What an idea. Just listen. And then we plunge into the theme, good and fast and agitated, like this. Isn't that exciting, Maestro Z?
Exciting? It's sacrilege. The minute you enlarge those pauses, you are automatically adopting a slower tempo for the first two bars. That's simple arithmetic. Then you follow up with a fast tempo in the next six bars.
So what? Why is that so terrible?
My dear colleague, Beethoven has set down one tempo mark for the whole movement, allegro. You have already played in two tempi in the first eight bars. You have therefore disobeyed the master's written instructions. That's what's so terrible.
I have not disobeyed. I have only taken certain small liberties, perhaps infinitesimal ones if they were to be measured, which satisfy my instinct for tension and release, for tightening and relaxing the tempo.
What about my instinct, which tells me that the two chords must be played in exactly the same tempo as the melody that follows, like this. One, two, three, 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 one. All one tempo.
But listen, you must admit that this is a dramatic work. Why not treat it that way?
How do you know it's dramatic? The main theme itself sounds anything but dramatic, so smooth and even and flowing. La-di-da-da-di-da-da. It's noble and lyrical, but never dramatic.
On the contrary, the theme is not lyrical. It is dramatic and agitated. But just look at what happens after four bars of it, how that dissonance suddenly intrudes like a dark villain. That's drama. And what about those breathless syncopations on top of the dissonance? Don't they signify agitation?
You are arguing foolishly. You prove that there is drama on either side of those four thematic bars, but you still haven't shown me that the theme itself is dramatic, and you never will.
All right, then, we'll make it dramatic.
What? How can you do that? Certainly not by making dynamic phrasings with waves and swells like this.
Certainly not. I'm not that kind of a libertarian. I can achieve the agitation very simply through the way we perform the accompaniment of the theme. We simply play those repeated eighth notes very short and sharp, like needles, this way. And that will lend the theme underneath the quality of agitation, like this.
You see? But my dear Maestro A, Beethoven has said nothing about short and sharp and needles.
And so on into the night. Now, of course, this conversation can be repeated ad infinitum on all kinds of subjects from every angle. Remember, we have been discussing only the first eight bars of a symphony containing 1,853 bars, and there are endlessly more things to be argued in just those eight. But even so, in this little dialogue, we've touched on the great sensitive areas of tempo, dynamics, style, character, phrasing, all of them interrelated and mutually influential. You see now why tempo cannot be an isolated subject to be decided upon independently. That's why musical instinct is so important. It's only the intuitive musical gift of a performer, not his thought processes, that can juggle around so many aspects of a given work and arrive at a general conception of how to approach it. And so we must revise our first question. It is not, after all, what do I as conductor want from this music, nor is it even what does Beethoven want, but what is it that I understand Beethoven to have wanted? It is this marriage of gifts that makes the performer so important, the chemical union of the composer's intentions with the gifted performer's understanding of them. Only this union can animate and transform the printed score into an event of consummate importance. Now, in a few moments, the great young pianist Glenn Gould is going to play with us a movement from a Bach concerto. Gould and Bach have become a kind of legendary combination in spite of Gould's extreme youth and Bach's extreme age. Now, of course, Gould has exactly the same performance problems with Bach that our friends conductors A and Z have had with Beethoven, only more so, because Bach, way back there in the early 18th century, belonged to a time when composers weren't being very generous with information about how to play their notes. Just look at this first page from the D minor concerto we're going to hear. We are told what instruments are playing, like a dramatis personae, and we are told what notes they play. But besides that, there's nothing but a pitifully few clues to performance. Allegro, fast, piano, soft, and a few signs making certain notes short or smooth. Then look at this page later on in the same work. Nothing at all but the notes. Not a word about performance, not a sign of phrasing or dynamics or accents. Now, does it mean that this whole passage is to be played with no dynamic variety at all, just as it appears on the page, like this? That's unutterably dull. But on the other hand, to what extent can the pianist supply dynamic variety? Perhaps he could mold the music a bit by mirroring its rise and fall with analogous rises and falls of volume, like this. That might might be one way of solving the puzzle, but there are countless other ways, and I'm sure Mr. Gould's way will undoubtedly be different, based on his own judgments, instincts, and highly individual personality. The problem is almost exactly like interpreting a page of Shakespeare, who was equally uninformative. Only look at Hamlet. You see dramatis personae, then you find Act One, Scene One, Elsinore, a platform before the castle, Francisco at his post, enter to him Bernardo. Bernardo, who's there? That's all. No description of the set or of the period, the costumes, the characters, nothing. Is Bernardo huge or tiny? 20 years old or 40? Is it a cold night? Windy, cloudy, raining? Not a word, just Elsinore and who's there. Now, if we're directing Hamlet, how could we decide about that opening line of Bernardo's? Is he a confident type of guard who will bellow, "Who's there?" Or is he a scared type who will whisper shakily, "Who's there?" Or is he a matter-of-fact guard who simply asks a routine question, "Who's there?" As if he had been asking it a dozen times already that night. Well, the only answer is to be found by reading the play, studying it, learning about the characters from their entire dialogue, and from the events that ensue. Well, that's exactly our situation with Bach. In order to decide on a general approach to these taciturn pages of black notes, we must study the whole work, get to know its insides, and then draw our conclusions. So Glenn Gould must decide, and I, as his accompanist, must decide with him all kinds of matters of tempo and phrasing and everything else that we feel necessary to convey Bach's deepest musical meanings to you, the listener. For example, is the opening statement of the concerto a rich, deep-voiced utterance to be delivered smoothly and grandly like this? Is it a highly inflected utterance, a sequence of short, separate, little phrases which, strung together, might make a more varied and interesting sentence, like this? Well, whatever it turns out to be, it will probably not be in either of the extreme styles we have just illustrated, but something between, containing both richness and inflectedness. In any case, what it will not be is a dull, literal playing of the notes, if I know Mr. Gould.
Thank you.
Perhaps the main qualification of a great performer lies outside all these considerations of knowledge, tradition, judgment, instinct, and so on. And we might call it the artist's demon. For once the actual moment of performance arrives, in that moment, there's nothing to do but throw the book away and plunge in. And that's when the performer's demon takes over and possesses him. It's a composite demon containing equal parts of a compulsion to perform, a deep need to communicate, and a fierce love of music. And it is that demon which turns a performer into a star and gives him the power to project and radiate to a large public. Such a star is the brilliant dramatic soprano Eileen Farrell. She has the same demon that possesses Glenn Gould, only her instrument happens to be her own voice. But while Gould showed us his solution to the problem of dynamicizing those uninformative little black notes of Bach, Miss Farrell is going to illustrate the opposite problem. What do we do with music that has an abundance, even an overabundance, of instructions to the performer? For you see, as music grew from the classical rigors of the 18th century into the romantic freedoms of the 19th, composers began to give more commands and more emotional commands. As the expressive horizons of music widened, it became necessary to supplement the bare notes with all kinds of expressive directions, accents, short notes, long notes. Just look at any page of Mahler, Stravinsky, Puccini, or Tchaikovsky. There's hardly a bar of this kind of music that's not filled with words or symbols to instruct the performer in how to play the notes. Now, in this kind of more recent music, we find a fascinating and disturbing thing, as you would think that now, when we have so much information to go on, so much given fact about the notes, that there would be practically nothing left for the performer to do but simply follow instructions. But not at all. The performer is still in his paradise of possibilities, just as he was in that page of Bach or the page of Hamlet we looked at before. To continue that analogy, you have only to jump from Shakespeare to Shaw and look at the opening of Man and Superman. What do we find? Over 2 pages of fine Shavian description before we even get to the first dialogue. Now, in this endless stage direction, Shaw is describing Roebuck Ramsden, who is the first character to speak in the play. He practically paints Ramsden's study for us, as well as the gentleman himself. We even know the color of his trousers. There's a whole paragraph on his exact age and the significance thereof, his bodily pose, his taste in art as seen on his walls, even his address is furnished us. And then finally, the action begins as he welcomes to the room a young man who is in mourning. And we read his first line, Ramsden, concluding the handshake and cheering up, "Well, well, Octavius, it's the common lot. We must all face it someday. Sit down." Now, how many ways can you read that line? Does Ramsden's cheering up involve a kindly smile in an attempt to minimize the sadness of the occasion? "Well, well, Octavius, it's the common lot." Or is the cheering up done in proper paternal tones suited to the funereal occasion? "Well, well, Octavius, etc." Or does the line follow a long sigh and emerge reflective, philosophical, resigned? "Well, well, Octavius." You see, we're facing a knotty problem in that no matter how far the creator of a work goes in detailed description of the emotional content he intends, it's still finally up to the interpreter to dig out the ultimate secrets. In Italian opera, for instance, where you're dealing with a wide gamut of immediate and exaggerated dramatic emotions, you will find the composer giving you all kinds of verbal annotations to the music itself. And yet the liberties taken in performances of Italian opera are so enormous as to be legendary. Just take the famous aria from the last act of La Gioconda, the soprano's big moment when she screams, "Suicidio, suicide, you are all I have left." Now that, you must admit, is an emotional occasion, as you will soon discover when Miss Farrell sings it for you. But look at the music. The composer, Ponchielli, tells the soprano to make not only a crescendo, that is to get louder, but crescendo con passione, with passion. Now, what kind of direction is this? Can passion be measured? Is passion a musical value? Well, how else could she make a crescendo except with passion? Since the words she's singing are, "I've lost my mother." She's singing, "Perde la madre, perde la madre." Is that a passionate enough crescendo, or is it too passionate? Well, Miss Farrell must decide. Then, toward the end of the aria, we find the word tenuto planted on the soprano's big high B. A tenuto means held, but held how long? Long enough to make the phrase passionate or desperate? Domando al cielo, or long enough to show off the soprano's best and biggest and highest note? Domando al cielo. Well, again, Miss Farrell must decide. And all these decisions left to the performer, in spite of the composer's wordy instructions, make her problem even greater than Gould's was with his Bach, namely, to take advantage of all these romantic liberties the composer desires, and at the same time, not to go overboard.
That's harder
than it sounds. But I think you will find that this difficult problem is met with great sensitivity and insight by Eileen Farrell as she sings the Suicidio aria from the last act of La Gioconda. Here we are, performers of the 20th century, singers, pianists, violinists, cellists, orchestral instrumentalists, and conductors, confronted by a musical literature belonging mainly to the two centuries which have preceded ours. Now, this may or may not be lamentable, but that's the way it is. The bulk of our repertoire is out of the classical traditions of the 18th century and the romantic ardors of the 19th. So we 20th century artists are constantly in the position of having to put ourselves back in time, of trying to recapture those past epochs. And no matter how much we study, no matter how much tradition we adhere to, no matter how much insight we may have, it is always to some extent guesswork. How wonderful it would be to have heard Bach or Beethoven perform their works. What we would give for a stereophonic record of Mozart playing one of his own piano concertos. But we never have to worry about this problem again, because today we have electronic devices that can capture the authentic original for all time, we hope. And so we can thankfully hear the greatest composer of our time, Stravinsky, performing his own works, telling us all those subtleties of his musical wishes and intentions which can never be fully documented in the cold black print of a score. We are going to have that privilege today, and I have the great honor of turning this podium over to Igor Stravinsky, who will conduct for us and for all the future the last three scenes of his ballet masterpiece, The Firebird. Thank you.
Ford Motor Company, maker of Ford Falcon, Fairlane, Galaxy, Thunderbird, Mercury Comet, Meteor, Monterey, and Lincoln Continental. Ford Motor Company, for 60 years the symbol of dependable products, has presented Leonard Bernstein and the New York Philharmonic in The Creative Performer. Produced by Robert Sodeck Associates. Written and narrated by Leonard Bernstein. With special guests, Glenn Gould, Eileen Farrell, and Igor Stravinsky. This program was pre-recorded.